Happy New Year!
Happy New Year!
I can't believe actually this many people are here. You guys need to get a life. Not really. How many went to bed before midnight? Yeah. Anybody go to bed before midnight? Yep. Some of you guys were. Of course. Mary Jane's till 2 o'clock. So we have an anniversary today. Happy anniversary to Nick and Jen. Yeah, woohoo! I think it's 14 years, is it? Yeah. Yeah. And it's David's birthday. He's a little older than 14, too. So happy birthday, David. We don't often get to celebrate like this on New Year's Day. So after worship, we have champagne and sparkling juice out in the gathering area. We hope everybody will stay and share your star word with each other. We're going to pick a star word, except it's not really a star word this year. It is an angel word. So we have angel word, and you can hear from our scriptures, we've got some talk about angels. So we've got angel word this year. You can stick it on a star if you want, because I've got a collection of star words, but it's the same kind of thing. It just happens to be an angel word, a word to focus on. Don't get obsessed with it. Just notice where it bubbles up in your life this year. Stick it in your phone if you have a place in the back of your phone or your billfold or your pocket or your mirror or wherever you can look at it. And just notice where it might bubble up and be calling you to be or to see this year. So we just have a little fun with that every year. Let me see what else we've got going on. Oh, next week after worship, we're going to share King's Cake and transform this space. So this will be up through Epiphany, which is the 6th. And then we need all your help in taking it down and putting it away after worship. So we'll have King's Cake and do that. It is the 6th, my friend. I was wrong. Yes, it's the 6th. So trust me that I did my numbers on my counting. We were talking about that the other day. It's like, when is Epiphany? And for some reason, I just spaced that out. And so we were double guessing when that was. So that will be Friday, I do believe. And we'll share King's Cake and take everything down after worship next week.
It's always January 6th.
Yes. Yep. 12 Days of Christmas begins on Christmas and goes to Epiphany. So we all tear everything down after Christmas. Some people leave it up through Epiphany when the kings come, which we know was really a couple of years later. But we celebrate these days, and they're good days. It used to be a high and holy day in church, where you would come back to church, like Ascension Sunday. But now we incorporate them into the life of the church for most of us. So let's sing happy birthday to David, since we can and we get to. David, you want to come up front? Just kidding. Yeah. I love this. It usually like sneaks by, and now we get to celebrate. All right, let's sing happy birthday to David.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday. I think you were surrounded by family. Mark said he saw Marie at the grocery store. No, who said? Jordan saw Marie. You're not at the grocery store without me. Jordan saw Maria at the grocery store. Or Morgan, one of those kids of mine.
Morgan.
Yeah, Morgan did. All right. It's like one of those kids. Who did? So that was fun. Little reunion at the grocery store. So as we begin this day reflecting the sacred, this is our last Sunday of this series, and we're going to talk about sacred doing. And boy, that's been bubbling up in my head as I think about New Year's resolutions and different things like that. So we will spend some time in scripture and the word listening and thinking about what that means. So this is the day of new beginnings, and let us open with that first verse of that song.
Time to remember.
practice that one. We will get another chance during communion. We're going to play with that. Here we are for the last time, kind of sitting in contemplation together. And as this series draws to a close, I want to encourage you to take some time this year in contemplation to think at home and see what's resonated with you. Give yourself a bit of a respite and calm. We're going to all need that this year, respite and calm. So here on January 1st, it's the threshold of a new year. It is appropriate for us to settle in and start this calendar year with aligning ourselves in the quiet of reflection, reflecting the sacred within us so that we might be inspired to be God's sacred doing in this world. When we just run around and we don't put God at the center, all we're doing is a bunch of doo-doo. But when we put God at the center and remember things are sacred, then we are sacred doers as well. So I invite you to get comfortable wherever you're sitting. Plant your feet on the floor, ground yourself. You can put your hands upward in your lap or whatever position that's become your favorite position for these moments of quiet. Close your eyes if you're comfortable doing so and take a deep intentional breath in. Blow it out. If it's difficult to get your mind to quiet down, if you're making New Year's resolutions in there, it's okay. Don't judge it. Just take another breath in. Thank and excuse it for just a moment, that mental gymnasium in your brain. Blow it out. Settle in. Now bring to your mind's eye, to your memory, to your imagination, a moment in your life where you were invited to help someone. Remember the empathy you may have felt and the feeling, that relief of knowing you can make this person's situation a little bit better. Now remember a time in your life when you felt helped by someone else. Maybe it was a simple conversation, a piece of advice like buying a colorful raincoat, a comforting word, or something tangible and practical that solved some dilemma for you. Let yourself become aware of the feeling that brings that back to you in your memory. Now imagine particles of light showering slowly upon either or both of these scenes. Let that reflection of light be an anointing for you, for the opportunities you will have this year for being part of God's sacred doing that must occur in our relationships, our families, our church, and our world. Imagine that each time an exchange of help occurs, this is a reflection of the sacred. It's the Christ mirror showing us God's hope, love, joy, and peace in abundance. Continue just to breathe, listen, and see with your heart. Repeat an echo prayer. Young people, I hope you'll join with us. Just repeat after me. We pray for a new start this day. We open to see the sacred reflected in all things. We open to see each relationship as a gift of holy presence. This is the gift of the Christ mystery.
This is the gift of the Christ mystery.
Lighting the way to the future. Living God, Christ mystery, Spirit of new beginnings, we give you thanks for this commitment to help one another. As we take in the renewed life you offer, may we be a reflection of your light, expanding the sacred doing of our community to the alleviation of suffering wherever it is found. And all God's people say, let us join our voices in singing this summons. Last slide on the screen for a second. So this has question marks on there. Where is this statement, which is so like true? We might say it, but we're really asking it. It's like, oh God, you know, if I just call your name, will your summons echoes true? We sing it as a statement, but in reality, we question whether we really, really can follow God like that. So this sacred doing should leave us wondering what we are called to do this year and make it a statement instead of that question mark. If we can trust God, let's move and live and grow with God in us and us with our hearts grounded in God. So I just love the serendipity that does happen, and then the giggles that I see back in the room sometimes. So you get a good vantage point from here. It makes a smile. So we've been looking at the sacred and refracting the sacred, looking at things as life light passes through prisms and things like that. We're charged to look at that, how light can be redirected in ways that can make brilliance more visible. So as we encounter the message today, let's see the world in our own light and our own lives and loved ones in a different light, one that invites us to know more deeply the sacred nature of all things. We've been looking through this lens of the sacred and have experienced time, people, places, others, and ourselves as God's holy love reflected and incarnate in the world, made alive in the world. Because of the experience, God's action of love happens towards us. We are called also to act. This sacred doing of alleviating suffering wherever it is found. That's easier, again, said than done. I can click on a Facebook message and say I prayed or do a thumbs up or do prayer hands. But to actually help alleviate suffering in a world means doing something. So may we dedicate ourselves in this new year to sacred acts of justice and mercy, finding grace in a hurting world, reflecting the sacred in all that we do. As we hear our readings for this day, let us think deeply about what they're calling us to be. From Isaiah 63, verses 7 through 9. I will recount the gracious deeds of the Lord, the praiseworthy acts of the Lord, because of all that God has done for us, and the great favor to the house of Israel that he has shown them according to his mercy, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he said, surely they are my people, children who will not act deceitfully, and he will become their savior in all their distress. It was no messenger or angel, but his presence that saved them. In his love and pity, it was he who redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the days of old. The word of God for the people of God. In our reading from Matthew 2, 13 through 23, this is the horrible story of what happened after the Magi had left. Now, after the Magi had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, get up, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there until I tell you. For Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him. Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night and went to Egypt and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Out of Egypt I have called my son. When Herod saw that he had been tricked by the Magi, he was infuriated and he sent and killed all the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had learned from the Magi. Then what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled. A voice was heard in Ramah, wailing in loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be consoled because they were no more. When Herod died, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, get up, take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who were seeking the child's life are dead. Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was ruling Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And after being warned in a dream, he went away to the district of Galilee. There he made his home, in a town called Nazareth, so that what had been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled. He will be called a Nazarene. The word of the Lord. Obedience. Like Joseph, listening and hearing. When I read both those scriptures, I'm reading Isaiah. It was no messenger or angel, but his presence that saved them. And yet you hear the angel tell Joseph, an angel, the messenger of God. Last night I was thinking about this new year that was ahead of us. I can get freaked out about New Year's Eve sometimes. And it's like, I don't want the new year to even know I'm here. May it pass me over. But for some reason, last night, it's like, I'm going to embrace this new year. We are going to enter into this new year filled with confidence that God is with us. And when we were in Ecuador, the people shared their New Year's Eve traditions. It is like a combination of the 4th of July, Halloween, and Christmas all combined. It's the biggest celebration they like to have. I think about the mask I gave Debbie Schippel that she used for Halloween, right? Christmas, but you had it up some other time as well. Maybe Halloween too. And that she used it for Christmas with this beautiful Christmas tree with a mask on top like only Debbie Schippel can do, you know. So all ages take to the streets in Ecuador. They have live music. They have competitions. They have these paper mache dolls that they burn at midnight. They make these dolls with old clothes that they don't use anymore. And by burning those dolls at midnight, it's an opportunity to leave behind all the prejudice, all the problems, all the sadness of the old year. And every new year is a chance to start over again. What a great thought. It's a great practice to have. And there's another tradition some people practice. The people that live in the towns, they take an empty suitcase and they run around the closest town square with that suitcase. It's a way to attract adventure and prosperity for the new year. Now, I thought about doing that, but, you know, we live in the country and there's, you know, it's really ineffective. And by midnight, I was in bed asleep. So it didn't happen, but I thought about it. It's like, what a wonderful thing to do. Now, there are some other traditions, too, like using was the word they said, using yellow underwear during the day. I don't happen to have any yellow underwear, but, or putting a dollar in your shoe. Now, that's something I can do for prosperity, but it's fun to think about traditions that people do and why they do it. We have choices. Like Joseph, we have choices this new year, whether we can embrace the new year and listen and reflect the sacred. So my choice is to listen for where God is calling us. So many people I tell about a book Parker Palmer wrote, Let Your Life Speak. And that book was transformational for me because it reminds me to look when a door closes or we can get stuck in a bad place, to simply turn and look because God is opening a new door. And or maybe it's just a window that we're called to turn to. But it is there if we can get past ourselves and interact with God to reflect the sacred and notice where God is calling us. Hear those messengers. During Advent, we were intentional about sacred time, how we interacted with God's sacred people and places, all of the earth. I hope that we as church can be more intentional with our recycling, that we can do it at home, we practice here so that we can be better in the world. This year might be a good time to make a choice about making our relationship with God a priority. Again, church is a good place to practice that which we need to live more fully out there. Invitational interaction, care of creation, love of neighbor, even those neighbors that get on our nerves. Justice issues. Noticing the sacred and living into the sacred. Maybe your New Year's resolution should not be about weight or eating or exercising or finishing that project. Maybe it should be about growing in our spiritual life and noticing how everything else will fall into place when we do. One thing I'd really like to lift up is the importance of growing into that spiritual life in community. Sometimes we want to take it to ourselves and just read alone at home or think or contemplate or know. But wherever two or more are gathered in my name, we are called to interact with each other, to throw ideas, to hear how God has touched another person or revealed something in another person. It's through community that we learn. So what are you going to do to grow? You know, I have had the opportunity to listen to some of your voices in some strange and wonderful ways. I was listening to this recording of the song for the kids. How about that kid, those kids singing on Christmas Eve? That was so much fun, and it was hard for Felix, who had practiced so well, to sing this part. And then other voices come forward loud and strong, but that is God in community. When God uses our gifts to bring about the confidence of others to sing a joyful noise, that's what God calls us to do and be. So in that recording that all the kids had, which they learned, which we didn't even think they were going to learn, I heard your beautiful voice in the background, Hillary, so you're busted. And then yesterday I got to sit by Jen Lure, who was singing at the hockey game, and it's like, huh, she's got a really beautiful voice as well. Busted. God's gifts are all about there. And it's not about getting that rousing clap for us. It's about having others or helping others experience the Spirit when we sing a joyful noise. Or when we mess up a song, you know, it's about learning it together. So we're going to practice that song just with a melody line before we all try to sing that together. We're just up here being servants of God, right? Trying to sing, trying to help lead, trying to help people grow in the faith. So when you follow God, you cannot take a wrong turn. When you pray to God, you cannot lose hope. When God fills your thoughts, you are sheltered from all error. When God holds you up, you cannot fall. When God protects you, you are never afraid. When God leads you forward, you are never tired. When God's grace shines on you, you arrive at your goal. I saw the prayer shawls the other day and little kids in the room. And I thought, uh-oh, your prayer shawls might have been touched. I hope there was nothing that you had to redo, but there was beauty in that moment. When children were surrounding prayer shawls, a ministry that's hidden in a back room over there, that we get to peek sometimes when you come up and you see a car at church. If you come in, you might see a light under the window there, and you can see people weaving. So to see the children surrounding the prayer shawl, wanting to know what that was and touching it as if it was a sacred thing, which it is sacred, and to explain to them how those shawls are prayed for throughout their weaving was a beautiful sharing moment of a ministry that not everybody knows about. Downstairs in our fellowship hall, we have a whole nother ministry of feeding children. And then you see people dash out of here on the third and fourth Sundays as they go over to the food pantry when church might go a little bit long. Another ministry that goes on. We have ministries weave in and out of this church. We have a music ministry downstairs that Keith says, oh, whatever. But it's powerful as you teach new generations to play music. So sometimes we're here for meetings and we can hear the sound of music bubble up from the basement. It's a beautiful thing. The church is alive and well, and may this new year bring you closer to God. May we grow in ministry together. May we be invitational and invite people to come in to this space where we practice, all bet imperfectly, but we practice so that we may go out into the world. And may you, may we all be awakened to the mystery of all life. We are wells of the sacred. God's presence is poured into creation in a never-ending flow of love. So let us enter a time of prayer that invites us to be refilled in ways that can help us pour out our love throughout the week. All we must do in this moment is open our hearts to the Holy One. To share our joys and concerns at this time. I see Judy. Wait a second. We need to lift up Ruth Ann. Yeah, Ruth Ann Branch. And this week was just a fast and furious time for her as she lost Bobby. The funeral will be Tuesday at Moran Funeral Home. At 11 o'clock with visitation Monday at 5 to 7. We're having a lunch here afterwards, so we hope that others can help us provide food. We have the ham provided by Hugh, and then we are all just pitching in to help and work and feed that family then. So, all right, Ruth Ann's online.
For a St. Peter person that I got to know. Her name is Jennifer Mall. She is the daughter of Steve and Charlene Smith up there. And Steve was a postmaster in Centralia, or postman, for a long time up in Centralia. She has had 7 surgeries since before Christmas. She has a rupture in her small intestine. She has several IVs on her. I mean, like double digits, 10 to 12 at varying times. Drains in her that they are trying to get this hole to heal up, and it just keeps getting worse. She had had a brain surgery previously years ago. So prayers for Jennifer, if you would please, and her family.
Yeah. Oh, Lord, hear our prayer. Prayers for Jennifer. Stephanie's got one. That's all right, Cindy.
Yeah, we need to lift up Alan and Melissa Ho. Alan lost his brother this week.
Yeah, his funeral's Tuesday as well. Yeah. Oh, Lord, hear our prayer.
Yes, I'd just like some prayers for Taylor. He starts the academy tomorrow, and he'll have 6 months, he said, of the academy in St. Louis.
And so he's worried about it.
And so he's a little worried about it and his diabetes and making sure he, you know, does good in all the stuff they have to do. So he's just a little on edge, and we could use your prayers for him.
Stephanie's son enters the police academy. He's got diabetes, had it since he was little. So he's a little worried about it. 6-month process. So we continue to pray for Taylor. Oh, Lord, hear our prayer. Ed?
Well, I just had a good thing happen for me, like a reinforcement. And I was getting my car serviced. A service person was driving me back with my car. And the road was very icy and bad on Moon Glow Road. It was a hill there. And unfortunately, we saw a lady pull off and get stuck. And we stopped and said, is there anything we can do? And she said, no, she had help coming. But when I got back to the house, I called up City Hall. And rather than get upset, I'm just working at a different approach, which would be, I said to the mayor's office, I'm not complaining, but we have the biggest hill in Centralia, and it's really icy, and a lady went off at 8 o'clock. And then I went over and I called City Works. And I said, look, I'm not complaining, but I'm just saying that we have the biggest hill in Centralia, and a lady went off at 8 o'clock. And my friend Nancy Gibson, when she came back from coffee, said the road was all clear, so I was happy about that. But what I'm more happy about is just to be calm with people. And a lot of people are just on the service line. They're not being paid much. So yesterday, I brought the car in to get a tire repaired at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. This is on Friday, I mean. And had my appointment, got there early, and hour after hour, I'm sitting in there, and I decided, this is not the gal's fault who's at the desk. So I just went and talked to her a little bit and said, it must be really hard that you're going through this, and all and she said, yeah, the manager's gone, and worker's not there, and so by the time I got the car, it was 4 hours later, 4 hours and 15 minutes, but I was just happy that I wasn't taking it out on anybody, and I was more understanding about they're in a jam. Like, I was just thinking of all the people at the airports servicing the crowds with all the emotions. How could they be paid enough to deal with all the upsets? So what was good for me, though, was just to reinforce that kind of approach. And that's what I wanted to say. I want to add one more thing to it. Years ago, the lawyer, Eddie Veltman, advised me on something. We had to put up a sign at the Presbyterian Church, and the zoning person said, you can't put it there. It has to be next to the building, which would have been no good at all. And we knew it was okay where it was going to be. And so we had to appeal to the zoning board in Centralia. And Eddie Veltman said, Ed, now when you go in there, don't go in angry or anything. Just go in like this. Put your arms out and say, can you help us? And that really worked. The city manager at that time came in and opposed us, along with one of the people on the zoning board, but everybody else voted for us, and it came through. But it taught me a lesson. Can you help us, rather than say, these dirty rats are trying to stop us.
That's right. Shauna, you have helped me with that same attitude there when we work with the company you work with. It said that when you ask for advice, you get help. And so when you, can you help us, you can get that. But it's being intentional about that, because our first response might be to get angry or to get impatient, right, Mark Tate? Sometimes I have to talk him off of the wall. It's like, it's okay, it's not their fault. So yeah, it is about reflecting the sacred, being intentional about that.
Sonia's online and requesting prayers for her family.
Yeah, Sonia definitely needs prayers for her dad. He is struggling right now, and the whole family is trying to provide 24-hour care, and that's a tough one. It's hard. I'd also like to lift up some young people in our church life that need our prayers and support, both Lily and Rachel. Lily Hongsmeyer and Rachel is Leonard's granddaughter. They both continue to reach out to the church and need some help and support. So if we can keep them in prayer, that is really, really good too. We don't know the fingers and the webs and the lives that reach out to the church for help and support and guidance, and they're happening all around us. So let's keep our young people in prayer. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. God, you have heard some of our requests, and there are many, many more that we hold deep in our hearts. Many families have lost loved ones this year. That pain does not go away quickly. Help us all learn to live in the tapestry of life, to weave that grief and joy into our life, to learn from it, to embrace it, to not fight it, but to use it to reach out and love. You are always with us, God. Help us remember that and know that, not dig into the panic and the fear and the way that can make us react. God, we ask for you to curb our tongues and help us see you, and then help us mirror your love with your earth, with your people. God, help us see that you are with us, before us, behind us. Help us literally see that as we look at our neighbors and imagine as we pray the prayer of St. Patrick saying, Christ with me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ in me, Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ on my right, Christ on my left, Christ when I lie down, Christ when I sit down, Christ when I arise. Amen. We offer our gifts and return them back to God. Let us imagine ministry. Let us imagine our place in the ministry of this church, touching children, wrapping people in love and prayer, feeding the hungry in our neighborhood, writing for justice, speaking out in love. We can make a difference together as we give with open and loving hearts. Let us reflect the sacred in our giving. Lord God, you continue to bless and multiply our gifts. Stir our imagination. Invite us into your ministry. Help us embody your love. We ask for your blessing to be upon these gifts, that they may be a blessing to the people they touch. Amen. You may be seated. Janet, will you just play the tune we're going to sing with your... And Nick, will you put the words up for the first verse? This is a day of new beginnings. We will practice it all together because we're going to sing the verses throughout our communion. Try it again with it.
Do you want lower?
I vote for lower.
Yes. Please.
Everybody votes for lower. She can press the button and take it lower. This little thing for us. Okay, if you'll stand up when we're doing it, might not be able to see her, but let us join into a prayerful presence as we are invited to this table. Christ invites to this table all who are ready to move forward, to move beyond the limitations of the past, all who are eager to move into this new thing that God is reflecting in our midst. All who are willing to let go of the pain that's gone. Open invitation to come. Receive the bread that will sustain us as we embark on this new calendar year. All are invited to receive the sweetness of the cup as a sign of God's promise of abundant possibilities. All are invited to this meal. All are forgiven their past regrets and invited to God's grace-filled future. Praise to the living God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart in this new day.
Lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Doesn't sound like it's right to give our thanks and praise. All right. Let's put it up there again and let's do it like we really believe that. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts in this new day.
Lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, O God, creator and renewer of all life. Time and time again, you seek us out, breathing again the breath of life into the deflated places in our lives. And so we come to your table to praise you and taste yet again what your steadfast love can do.
Our God is making all things new.
is your son, Jesus the Christ. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with those considered unworthy. Through him, faith and hope were born again for so many. Jesus was betrayed. After giving thanks to God, he broke the bread. Shared it with his people and said, "Each time you eat of this, do so in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup and gave thanks to you. Gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant. Each time you drink this, do so in remembrance of me." And so, as we receive this bread, and as we remember the words and acts of Jesus the Christ, we offer our own lives, leaving behind what we do not need, seeking new paths full of new life in Christ. And as followers of Christ, we proclaim and live out this holy mystery, saying, "Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again." On us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make for them, be for us, the body and blood of Christ, so that we might be for the world the body of Christ, breaking ourselves open to your future. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes again in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus the Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. For communion this morning, and know that if you cannot, we will come to you. We have gluten-free bread for all to share, and we will be making a sign of the cross with you on your foreheads as our final anointing for this worship series, in which we have seen all things, including us, made in the light of Christ and anointed as a shining reflection of the sacred. So if you're worshiping with us at home, gather some bread, some juice, some wine, and after you've eaten what you have there, feel free to give yourself that sign of the cross. Do it whenever you need to be reminded. You may use oil, you may use your lotion, or you may just make that sign. The sign of the cross comes from this ancient ritual of early Christians. It was done at their baptism. It's kind of a notary public stamp on your head that reminds us that we are connected with Christ always and forever. We'll be handing, or we'll let you pick out a star word or an angel word this day. And remember, after worship, we hope to gather in the gathering area and share those words with one another. So come now. Well, I need two ushers to come forward. And Felix and Graham, is Graham around? Can you all hold the Star Words, one on either side? Over there. You stand right there. And I need two people for the cups. And I will hold the bread. Juice is in the middle. Wine is in the cups on the outer ring. Here, Mary Jane, you switch there. Come. Now, the table is ready.
Thank you.
No fair picking. Got to pick one. Shh.
I'll flip them all over.
Pick one. Got it?
Yeah.
There we go. A cup of bread of life.
Okay.
And a cup of blessing.
Yes.
I'll get you one in a second. You got your hands full. He's got to come back up and pick one out. The bread of life for you, my friend. Bread of life for you, Mary Jane. Thank you. Cup of blessing. Did you? You got one?
I got one.
You got one? Got it? Everybody get a word? Did you get a word? My hands were full, so I did not do a cup of blessing. If you have not, take and eat, take and drink. Everybody, give yourself a sign of a cross. Know that you are a beloved child of God. Take and drink. Let us pray. God, we give you thanks for a time to get together to remember your mighty acts, your loving sacrifice, your love for the world. As we take in your body and your blood, help us be transformed. Help us receive that Christ light and to go out and do things in a sacred way, to use our words and our acts as a reflection of you and your love. God, you have given us a word. Help us reflect on that word to see where we can see it in the world, where we can be it in the world if we were called to do so. God, grant us peace, hope, joy, and love in this new year. Amen. As we go out into the world, know that you are a gifted and beloved people. Know that you have a sacrifice. I have a blessing I wanted to share with you all. It's a blessing that talks about the new year. May all that is unforgiven in you be released. May your deepest fears yield to your deepest tranquility. May all that is unlived in you blossom into the future graced in love. May you go out into this new year and reflect this sacred in the name of the Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, amen, amen and happy new year. Let us join together in the fellowship hall or in the gathering area and share a toast and our word for the day. Who? Leo didn't get one.
You're down and troubled, and you need a helping hand. Darkest night, you just call out my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running to see you again. Winter, spring, summer, or fall, all you got to do is call, and I'll be there, yeah, yeah, yeah. I've got a friend.